Tim Pat Coogan is a leading author in Irish history, a broadcaster and a newspaper columnist. He was editor of the Irish Press newspaper for nearly 20 years. He's written at least 16 major books, including biographies of Michael Collins and Eamon de Valera. In 2012, his book about the Great Hunger, The Famine Plot, spoke of ethnic cleansing and genocide. Last week, he published 1916, The Morning Xanathar, described as a strongly personal perspective on the Irish century that followed the Rising, charting a flawed history that is marked as much by complacency, corruption, and institutional and clerical abuse as it is by the sacrifices and nation-building achievements of the Republic's founding fathers. Would you welcome, please, Tim Pat Coogan.
John Redmond said about Wilson is a man, remember, of course, I take it you all know the broad outline of his life. He was in jail for bombings, dynamite shooting of London under the name of Wilson. And that's why Redmond begins by saying, Wilson is a man of whom no words of praise would be too high. I learned in my many visits to Portland for 5 years to love, honor, and respect Henry Wilson. I have seen day after day how his brave spirit is keeping him alive, was keeping him alive. I have seen year after year the fading away of his physical strength. Now, after going through that ordeal, as we know, Tom went to America, where he achieved a degree of modest prosperity. It's not often realized that he had some purchases of land there, some 60 acres of land. He married Kathleen, who was 21 years old, during he was happily married. And he deliberately came back to Ireland in the gap of danger. There, as we all know, his principal associate was Sean McDermott. Again, he is a man that you think about in human terms, not just a figure limping through history with a stick. He lived through life with polio. If you go today to Kilty Clare and look on that bare hillside, the tiny cottage where he grew up with a huge retinue of brothers and sisters, two rooms, one fire, just visualize what it was like growing up there. Think, for example, of the whole new fact of his mother probably pregnant, coming back from the village some miles away, up a hillside, in a boree in mud, with the groceries. Think of him educating himself in those circumstances and limping forward into history. Like Clark, he had a vision. He wanted to change those circumstances. He wanted to make a better life for those who came after him. And when we're commemorating 1916, we should remember that it wasn't just for violent, aberrant Irish nationalism. They had a concrete view of the kind of society they liked, and above all, what they wanted was freedom. Freedom to live in their own way, freedom to change the slums. General Maxwell, who shot him, came in a few months when he was here to see Ireland as a prime example of a discovered area. An area where politically at the top, the Orange element had been utilized by the Conservatives, by particularly Randolph Churchill's policy of fomenting revolution, Ulster would fight and Ulster would be right, carried on by the leader then of the Conservative Party, Bonar Law, telling people in Ulster that there was no lengths to which Ulster could go, that he couldn't imagine the British Parliament supporting him. And in response to that attempt to use the Irish situation for domestic political advantage in England to put out the Liberals, that, as we know, the Volunteers performed. And through split, counter split, and fighting sadly with John Redmond, a very tiny and very gallant body of men finally set out on Easter week, on Easter Monday. Now, one of the things that Maxwell had said, in the letter to his wife, and what we know afterwards, that the settlement could have been used, the generous, warm-hearted people, he said, would have accepted the settlement, would have reached out to him. And you think about the slums of Dublin, the housing situation, as being a disgrace, and a disgrace which could easily have been remedied. I'd like to think just about the housing situation for a moment. But they, Clarke and McDermott and others, why you wouldn't think of them as socialists. They were trying to improve the physical lot of people around them. And they were prepared, as Clarke's case, to give life. And McDermott, in his youth, in his happiness, from experiences born, the need to build family, to remedy that situation. They did want society which would cherish all the children of the nation equally. Wilson Clarke was oldish, I think, in the 60s by the time of the revolution. He went into the GPO in great pain. He had probably blown off the joint, done something during this revolver practice, would have put it through his elbow. And at that age, he went in to live for a week, feast under a shot, a shell, and a building on fire. And it's not surprising that Frank O'Connor talks about, in his book about Collins, as being fussy and going around and agitated. But there, dignified to the end, and commanding respect. Collins himself loved him, and lay with his arms wrapped around him to the night after they were corralled in Parnell Square to keep him alive, keep him warm. He took a particular care to track down a man who tried to humiliate him the following day, Captain Lee Wilson, intelligence officer, who had been stripped and paraded when he saw nurses at the window of the adjoining London Hospital. Collins made up his mind to get him, and did have a shot a couple of years later. Is instructive as things evolve and they change. The court also, but Lee Wilson's widow, who was a doctor, bequeathed things to the Jesuits, a painting which turned out to be a Caravaggio, which the Jesuits had given to the National Gallery. History, time moves on, but the ideas of the people lived at a certain time and died also involved, and they should be regarded as action, not as a text for action, not for lip service. Now, writing my eyesight goes out, I'd like to, it's not an exercise in narcissism, but this is a very little known interview, which I conducted for the purposes of my first book, which came out on the 15th anniversary. 50 years ago, with Clarke's widow, Kathleen. And I think that can let it speak for itself. She was then, by the way, 86, living out here in Balls Bridge, in a comfortable sort of house, two story. And she drove her own car. She was really indomitable. From time to time, as we spoke, she had an alcohol, a senior moment. And her concentration relapsed, and she'd drift off out there somewhere. And then gradually consciousness would come back. It would take 30 seconds. And she'd shake her head and zoom exactly where she had stopped. She really was an indomitable. And this is what I recorded, she describes being in incarceration here in the castle after a group of other women. And he says that I thought that in the morning we were likely to walk before the commanding officer. So I had taken off my blouse and skirt and hung them up so that I wouldn't look too bad. There were six of us, and we only one blanket. We've been very annoyed at some young British officers and soldiers from interfering with us. It was outrageous. Then an officer came and said, I have permission to see my husband. My God, Captain, said one of the girls. What does that mean? It means death, I said. Oh no, said the girl. Look, said I, do you think that the British government were going to send my husband on a journey any shorter than into the next world, that they get an officer in a car out at midnight to send for me? You're a stone, said the girl. I was. We were stopped several times. There were snipers on a lot of rooftops, and I didn't think we'd be let go on. But the officer showed his pass, and we got through. Kilmainham was terrible, the conditions. There was a monk downstairs. He told me that my husband had put him out of his cell. There was no light out, only a candle that a soldier lit. Why did you surrender? I asked Tom. I thought you were going to hold out for a month. I wanted to, he said, but the vote went against me. We talked about the future at the time. I never saw him so buoyant. He said that the first blow had been struck and Ireland would get her freedom, but that she'd have to go through hell first. I didn't cry. He had to face the ordeal by himself in the morning. If I broke down, it might have broken him down. I said, what did you do to that priest down there? That damn fella came in here, he said, and said he'd give me confession if I'd admit that I was wrong and said that I was sorry. I'm not sorry. I said to him that I gloried in what I'd done. I was expecting a baby, but didn't tell him that in case he might have said it. I asked an officer to send his body to me. He hemmed and hawed and said he'd have to take instructions about it. In the end, he promised to do something, but they wrote to me afterwards that I couldn't have the body for burial. I walked home by myself from the castle to Fairview. There was a smell of burning in the air. I had to walk in the middle of the road because things were falling off the roofs. In O'Connell Street, a big policeman stopped me. When I told him who I was and where I was going, he said, you'd better go down Fairview now. There's some soldiers up at Parnell Square and they're not very nice. I had to climb over a big pile of rubbish and rubble in North Aaron Street. The bricks were still hot. I never met a sinner all the time. I had sent the children out to Limerick and there was no one at home. I didn't think going for Granville Bristol, who I bought the house in case someone would come. I thought anyway, I'd get 124 hours of peace. And I had a bottle of port, so I filled myself out a glass of that. I thought it would be strong, but I was away from getting it now. My sister came up from the country, and that night, the lorry came and took us to Kilmainham to say goodbye to my brother, Davy. I heard it coming, and I turned around and I said, it's coming to take us to Ned. He's going to be shot. He thought I was going off my head. But a few minutes later, we all heard it. They stopped outside the house. My sister didn't want me to go, but I insisted. My brother was in uniform. He looked about 18. There was a group of officers outside the cell. They seemed to have something against me. The soldier holding the candle had been in my husband's firing party. He said that my husband was the bravest man he'd ever seen. I lost the baby about a week later. I don't know whether it was a boy or a girl. I was the caliber Clarke, Tom Clarke himself, and the 1916 leadership. Now, as I said, just to give one indication, you know, they were fighting for freedom. And in our time, in the last few years, we suffered an act of economic treason. We lost our economic sovereignty. We were put at the mercy of German bankers. We had to undergo a regime in which more people had died from suicide than were lost in the 30 years of the Troubles. Was that the vision of Tom Clarke and Kathleen and Ed Daly? There are, I know, whole generations, we know, living abroad through immigration over that, we've lost them. We've got the situation deteriorating, labor relations, 0 hours, people not knowing whether they can work next week, whether they can plan their lives or not. We've seen them happen to the clearance workers. Is that what they meant when they wrote in the proclamation? They envisaged a nation and cherish all the children of the nation. We have laws that prevent us finding out what's happening. Libel laws, wealthy lawyers getting wealthier, preventing bankers giving evidence before tribunals. In short, we have many of the impertinences of colonial rule still with us. Even the Freedom of Information Act has been aborted. You may have seen recently when Christine Murphy ended up in the Dáil, the result of 19 attempts under the Freedom of Information Act to find out something about Dennis O'Brien's dealings with NAMA. It was a line after line after line of redaction, just black lines. That was not what the people of 1960 had in mind. Now, it is not a question just of kicking the counter bar, having another drink and going home. You can do something about it. Apart from a heroic legend, a heroic fact, a heroic tradition, men in 1916 have agreed to us, in effect, the vote. You can change things. In this centenary year, it looks as though it's going to be an election. I would urge you, here in City Hall, what Michael Collins has laid out, and many other historic things have heard, to think, what are you going to do with your vote? Who are you going to vote for? There's a proliferation of independents which shows that people are not satisfied with existing parties. Young people are getting very disaffected, which is very dangerous and wrong. Democracy is priceless, the ability to vote is priceless. And I would encourage you all to take a look at your candidates. If you can, go along to the selection occasions. Join a party. Specifically, look at laws which should be changed. It isn't the principle of paying for water that you should be concerned. It's the fact that the local government system, by and large, absent of corruption, planning commission, and so on, is pretty good. There's a county manager. He knows, for example, he would know, without being told, that water pipes put down in Queen Victoria, made of earth, are apt to be leaking today. And he could have, with his plans and his staffs, he could have directed the government department, Department of the Environment, I would say, to go along and fix those things where they were. But instead, we much applied mechanisms and employed an entire coterie of officials, largely from the local government, to superimpose on the local government structure and create a company. Just one more quangle too many. And people have got more and more dissatisfied with it, and it's has become a cause for concern, and so it should be. We have people waiting in trolleys. We have, in my own family, I had somebody who died of bowel cancer, spent 3 days in a trolley before he got to bed. That was not what the men in 1960 died from. Just as with the water situation, this vast context of the HSC has been superimposed on the existing health boards, which are held to be inefficient and not doing their job. So we don't have enough nurses and doctors, but we certainly have enough about clerks and highly paid quote consultants. All these are matters that you can remedy yourself. You have the vote. You have the tradition of these men. You obviously have the interest, or you wouldn't have come on one of the sunniest and best days of the year. So I will conclude by saying to you, the words of Thomas Kids, gentlemen and ladies, you have a country. Protect it.
Thank you.